मॉर्निंग एवरीबडी, आई एम डॉक्टर नितिन जोशी, प्रोफेसर न्यूरोलॉजी विथ टीचिंग एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ 25 ईयर्स, वर्किंग एज कंसल्टेंट न्यूरोसर्जन इन पनवेल. इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी हैव सीन दैट विद द हेल्प ऑफ रिसेप्टोस्कोप एंड ऑब्चुरेटर वी हैव एंटर इन टू द ब्लैडर एंड देन वी हैव चेंज द विजुअल ऑब्चुरेटर विद द ऑपरेटिंग एलिमेंट, surgical working element or electrotome. Now this particular instrument has got special arrangement by which it will get locked into the external end of the resectoscope. So it has got one locking arrangement. Second, it has got what is called as the loop control mechanism. Now this loop control mechanism is of two types, and that is the Nesbitt's thumb operating element and Brumbacher's finger operating element. The advantage in case of Nesbitt's thumb operating element is that in the resting state also the loop, that is the active electrode, remains within the sheath even in the resting state. As a result, if by mistake one presses the cutting current foot pad, then because of the passing of the current, the loop is activated, that is the active electrode is activated, but still it is within the sheath. As a result, the inadvertent damage to the bladder is prevented, and so even if one is not very careful, that time also the inadvertent damage to the bladder and the surrounding tissues is prevented. Now in addition, it has got what is called as the viewing channel. Through this viewing channel, one can pass 0 degree scope or 30 degree scope. 30 degree scope is commonly used, and therefore it is called as universal scope. It is 4 oblique scope. 4 oblique, that is slightly forward oblique vision. Then it has got a attachment for the active electrode. Active electrode, so firmly the active electrode like loop or the ball electrode or hook can be attached because of presence of special arrangement. So provision for the firm attachment of the active electrode to the working element. Second, there will be always a clock click like sound which will show that the active electrode is firmly attached, because if there is attachment is defective, there can be short circuits and this can result into various disasters. And so the click of proper attachment, what is called as firm attachment of the active electrode to the working element, is essential. Also, it is provided with the attachment for the high frequency cord. So there is locking arrangement for the attachment of high frequency cord, where the other end of high frequency cord will be going to the electrosurgical unit, that is underwater cutting cautery, so that the current will be passing from the cautery to the high frequency cord to the active arm of the loop, that is the active electrode. It can be even the Collins knife or the ball electrode. So in case of the modern surgical unit, one is having internal instrument arrangement, that is through the inner sheath of the resectoscope the working element can be passed. And this working element, what we have seen is that this working element has got provision for the firm attachment of the active electrode, maybe the loop or ball electrode or hook, as well as the high frequency cord. So when you press the cutting current, then the cutting pad, then the cutting current will be passing from the high frequency cord to the active arm of the loop and then to the tissue. Similarly, when you are pressing the separate foot pad, that is for coagulating current, then the coagulating current will be passing from the high frequency cord to the active arm of the loop and then to the tissue. Now, this particular loop, what is we call as a loop, is an active electrode. It is a one type of active electrode. There are three types, that is the ball electrode, hook electrode, and the loop, cutting loop. Now, commonly used active electrode is a cutting loop. Now, this is a type of active electrode. It is made up of fine tungsten wire. It is thickness is measured in terms of millimeter. Now, it is called as the cutting loop, but it is used for both cutting and coagulation. In case of the size, the standard size of the loop is 0.35 mm and the thinner loop is 0.30 mm while the thick loop is 0.40 mm. If one sees, the loop has got the central portion and the side flanks or the lateral flanks. When you are resecting the adenoma of the BPH, that is the enlarged prostate secondary to hyperplasia, it has got significant stroma, and during the resection it is the central portion which enters the adenoma repeatedly, so the central portion is consumed more and more and rapidly, so the central portion of the loop becomes thinner as compared to the lateral flanks or the lateral aspects or the side flanks. They enter very less, so they are consumed less, as a result they become remain thick, and this thicker portion provides the wider surface area of contact that can be made use of during the process of coagulation. Because since it is not used, so it is thicker, so wider surface area, and this wider surface area is good from the point of view of coagulation, because when you touch the tissue, the loop will not sink in the tissue, and so the lateral aspects or the side flanks of the loop can be used for the coagulation process. While the loops which have been used in TURP, so the central portion of the loop has been consumed, it has become thinner. Sometimes we have seen that the incidence of breakage of the loops is more in the center because they are consumed more and more in the central portion of the loop. But the loops which cannot be used for TURP because they have been become thinner and thinner, finer and finer because of more and more consumption of the central portion, they are extremely useful for TURBT. This is because in case of bladder tumor, the stroma of the tumor is very very less as compared to adenoma. So if you use very strong current or the current like TURP, there will be one charring and the pieces will stuck to the loop, so the process will be hindered. Also, if the tumor is present on the lateral wall, then the currents which are used for TURP can result into the stimulation of obturator nerve, causing the contraction of the skeletal muscles, that is the obturator group of muscles, causing obturator jerk and the bladder perforation. So in this case, one has to use low current setting because one, you have to prevent the obturator nerve stimulation and obturator jerk, and secondly, if the thicker loop and the stronger current, in that case the pieces will be stuck. But if you use the thinner loop, in that case more is the thinner, more is the finer loop, higher is the density of the current at the point of contact. So whenever you are using a thinner loop, even if the energy output is less, because the density of current at the point of contact is strong, therefore, even with low energy output, low current setting on the cautery unit, the cuts will be smooth, precise, without charring. So, it setting lower cutting current in TURBT with the low current will be protected of the obturator jerk, but the loop should be thin so that the current, even if it is low current setting, the energy at the point of contact because of high density current will be adequate so as to achieve the smooth, precise cut without charring, and because of the low current setting, it will prevent the obturator jerk and bladder perforation. Now, the loop which is present, it can be single stem or the double stem. Now, in case of double stem, there is active arm and the passive arm. Now, the active arm is longer while the passive arm is shorter. Now, the active arm is longer. This is because on the right side of the high frequency cord, there is a hole, and through this hole, the long active arm of the loop goes into the high frequency cord, so that the current will be passing from the high frequency cord through only the active arm of the loop. On the other hand, the short arm of the passive electrode, passive arm of the loop, it will not be going on the left hand side of the high frequency cord, because on the left hand side of the high frequency cord there is no hole. So the current is passive only through the active long arm. The passive short arm remains at the surface of the high frequency cord and it gives only stability. Now, this yellow color, typically the yellow color is the code which is used for the resectoscope as well as for the loop. Now, this yellow color is insulation. This insulation has to be checked before you start TURP, because any insulation defect in the loop, any insulation defect in the sheath, that is vesical end of the sheath which has got the ceramic coating, Teflon made and ceramic coating, this insulation fault or improper connection of the loop, that is active electrode, to the working element, where you have to get that proper click so that you know that it has been properly locked. Any defect in the insulation, any improper connection of the loop to the working element will result into current leakage, that is the portion of the current will be diverted to the instrument. This current leakage, whatever, whether it is a coagulating current or the cutting current, because it is leaked, that much proportion of the cutting current or coagulating current is not passed through the loop and is not passed through the tissue. So the cut will be poor cut and the coagulation will be also poor quality. So at that time, checking the connections is very important, rather than increasing the setting of the cautery, whether coagulating or the cutting. Second important point, that is, in case of the loop, there is a 90 degree angle towards the insulation shoulder. This angle corresponds with the angle of the inner vesical end of the sheath, that is the short oblique inner end of the sheath. The angle corresponds with the angle of the loop with the shoulder of the insulated part of the loop. When you are retracting the loop, each time it should retract within the sheath so as to achieve a complete cut of the TURP. Now, once you enter into the bladder, one has to assess. We are starting with the third stage of TURP because we have entered into the bladder with the resectoscope with the help of visual obturator. After we enter into the bladder, we have removed the visual obturator, we have taken the thumb operating working element to which are attached the active electrode, that is the loop, and there is a 30 degree scope which is universal scope and the high frequency cord. Now once we are into the bladder, one has to assess the gland again in terms of the length and width of the prostate gland, because the length and width of the prostate gland at different places or different locations is different. One has to even measure the loop length, that is how much length, whether single loop or the double loop, from the bladder neck to veru, so that one gets assessment whether the cut, whatever we have to take, is it possible to have in single cut or divided cut, so as to have a proper orientation. Now, before one starts with the actual process of resection, you have to tell examiner, I will keep in mind certain principles of resection. One, I will do the entire process of resection in strict aseptic precaution. Second, I will do the procedure with adequate lubrication of urethra and adequate lubrication of all the instruments with water soluble anesthetic lignocaine jelly so as to prevent the friction of the instrument with the urethra, thereby preventing the friction injuries to the urethra and hence decreasing the incidence of post-TURP stricture. Also, I will see that I will not use any force while doing instrumentation, that is, allow the instrument to fall by its own weight, again to reduce the friction injury and the incidence of post-TURP stricture. I will do all the procedure under vision with good illumination with good irrigation flow. I will use the smallest possible instrument so as to serve the purpose. Then I will use the height of irrigation fluid above the symphysis pubis of the patient as low as possible, try to keep less than 60 cm of water so as to have less intravesical pressure, that is high hydrostatic pressure in the bladder, and high hydrostatic pressure in the prostatic fossa is responsible for increased incidence of TUR syndrome. So to reduce the complication of TUR syndrome, I will keep the height of irrigation fluid in the irrigation chamber between 45 to 60 cm above the symphysis pubis of the patient. When there is torrential bleeding, where the major bleeders are hitting the telescope directly, which blinds the vision, then only momentarily only the height of irrigation will be raised. As soon as the hemostasis is achieved, vision has improved, the height of irrigation should be lowered immediately. As soon as I start the process of resection, I will ask the anesthetist to note the time so that I will try to restrict or limit the time of resection or the time of entire process of the TURP between 45 to 60 minutes so as to decrease the incidence of TUR syndrome. Whenever I am attaching the TUR setting to the irrigation jar, then I will see that there is a full flow so as to expel all the air bubbles in the tubing. The commonest source of air bubble in the bladder is the air bubbles present in the tubing. If these bubbles enter into the bladder, then it always interferes with the process because it interferes with the hinders the vision. Since we are using high frequency current, generation of high temperature. So at this high temperature, there is electrolytic decomposition of water vapor, results into the formation of oxyhydrogen gas. The bubbles of this tend to collect in the fundus and dome of the bladder. So there is less space available for the irrigation fluid and TUR chips. Also, this oxyhydrogen is an explosive gas mixture. This can result into ignition, resulting into explosion and bladder perforation. And so, though I am using Iglesia type continuous irrigation sheath, like conventional type, I will try to remove the working element from the external end of the sheath intermittently so as to empty the bladder completely. At the time of emptying of the bladder by removing the working element, I will direct the inner end of the sheath towards the vault or the dome of the bladder where air bubbles will be collected. At that time, I will ask my assistant to give suprapubic pressure so that the fundus of the bladder will be directed towards the sheath, that is the inner end of the sheath, so the bubbles will be following, entering into the sheath and will be evacuated. Also, intermittent palpation of the suprapubic region by the assistant will give some idea about the presence of any induration, so that the assistant can give me that there is some palpable induration. Because if there is any inadvertent bladder perforation, there is extravasation of irrigation fluid causing induration. And so that will be the first sign that the assistant can give me that there is some induration, and so I should be careful that there may be some inadvertent unnoticed bladder perforation. So what are the advantages of the intermittent emptying of the bladder even if it is a Iglesias continuous irrigation sheath? One, that is emptying of the bubbles which are getting collected in the dome or the vault of the bladder. Secondly, that is whenever you are emptying, even if the external end of the outer sheath, I mean the internal end of the outer sheath which has got the holes or penetrations, sometimes they are blocked by the blood clots or the tissue debris. As a result, instead of Iglesia type, continuous type, it becomes a conventional type, and in conventional there is intermittent development of high hydrostatic pressure which can result into increased absorption of the fluid through the veins causing TUR syndrome. So if you empty intermittently, naturally that time the pressure in the bladder, intravesical hydrostatic pressure, will be as low as possible, almost zero. Also, intermittent emptying will help you to see the quantity and quality of the irrigation fluid which is being emptied. That is, if there is any bladder perforation, then the quantity of the irrigation fluid which is emptied will be less, which is classically described as difficulty in evacuation of the bladder. Also, if there is initial effluent from the bladder is clear, but the terminal effluent is dark, suggestive of venous blood. Also, in the Iglesia type of irrigation fluid, there is some amount of fluid is being continuously drained. Some amount of fluid is in the bladder, so that there is some hydrostatic pressure in the bladder. Also, huge volumes of fluid are entering into the bladder due to continuous irrigation. As a result, the finding the bladder becomes difficult. When the external end, from the external end, the working element is removed, bladder is emptied, intravesical pressure is almost zero. When you are entering into the bladder, the flow of irrigation, if we kept minimal, naturally the finding of the bladder, which may be missed, will be found out. Then you will tell examiner, I will follow absolutely stepwise systematic resection. That is, even a single field of resection, I will divide that into smaller resection zones. I will proceed from the initial resection field to the next only when it is completely cleared. This division of a single resection field into multiple small individual resection zones helps in orientation. This is because whenever there is sudden bleeder where major bleeder has opened, as a result the major bleeding will be seen. But if the field of resection is restricted, one knows from exactly where the bleeding has started, so one can make the search of the bleeder only in restricted area. Resection and coagulation goes hands in hand. So whenever there is transection of the vessel, it should be followed by coagulative closure as quickly as possible. And so you will tell the examiner that once the adequate hemostasis has been achieved in one particular small zone of resection, then only I will proceed with the next field of resection so as to prevent the loss of orientation because of excessive bleeding. Thank you very much.